Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sludge: What Stops Us from Getting Things Done and What to Do About It, by Cass R. Sunstein, narrated by Asa Siegel. Publisher's Note: This audiobook will refer to visual elements included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Sludge, noun, thick, soft, wet mud or a similar viscous mixture of liquid and solid components, especially the product of an industrial or refining process. Oxford Online Dictionary, 2019. Preface. This book is a product of a failure. During the presidency of Barack Obama, I was privileged to serve as the administrator of the White House Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs, OIRA, as it is called. OIRA is an obscure office with a small staff of about 50 people, but it plays a significant role in the U.S. government. It helps oversee the operation of the regulatory state, including healthcare, environmental protection, civil rights, highway safety, occupational health, food safety, agriculture, even homeland security. But it was originally created by the Paperwork Reduction Act, PRA, enacted in 1980, and one of its central missions is, well, to reduce paperwork. Which brings me to the failure. For most of my time at OIRA, I was focused on large and dramatic issues: economic growth, healthcare reform, financial stability, climate change, clean air, clean water, race and sex discrimination, public health, highway safety. Paperwork reduction mattered, for sure, but it was not the highest priority. That wasn't exactly wrong, but it wasn't quite right either. Countless programs, potentially benefiting so many people, end up failing because of excessive paperwork. Sometimes administrative burdens reduce economic growth and produce widespread unfairness. They even make people sick. Sometimes the victims are businesses, from the largest to the smallest, from the well-established to startups. Sometimes the victims are people who need some kind of license or permit, perhaps to work. Sometimes the victims are the most vulnerable members of society: people who are in poor health, disabled, depressed, elderly, or poor. Sometimes paperwork and associated burdens hammer identifiable groups, including women and people of color. It was not until relatively late in my 4-year stint that my team and I began to go hard at the problem. It was too late, and it was too little. In the years since that time, we have learned an immense amount about the damage done by paperwork requirements, waiting time, reporting requirements, clearance processes, and the like. Some of what we have learned involves what is actually happening on the ground, what public officials are doing to people, and how they are harming them by making them jump through an assortment of hoops. Some of what we have learned involves the human mind and its limits, which help to explain why such burdens can be so devastating. Some of what we have learned involves the private sector, which can damage its customers and its own employees by imposing sludge. In many cases, officials themselves have no clue about the consequences of paperwork and related requirements. In many other cases, they know exactly what they are doing. That is true of hospitals, businesses, universities, and other institutions as well. When people are required to jump through hoops, all sorts of bad things might happen, some of them surprising. One of the least surprising is that many people stop jumping. That might be a reasonable thing to do or essential to people's self-preservation, but in many cases, it is also a kind of tragedy. The good news is that a lot can be done to help. A roadmap of what is to come. Chapter 1 clarifies the key concepts and offers a short account of the underlying problem. Chapter 2 investigates why sludge is so harmful, with special reference to behavioral science. It emphasizes the problems of inertia, present bias, and scarcity, cognitive, not economic. In combination, these are a potent brew. They help account for the damage done by sludge, much more, often, than anyone ever intended. Chapter 3 explains that sludge is a product of architecture. Sometimes deliberately, sometimes by accident, it has a major effect on outcomes. It could easily be otherwise. Chapter 4 offers a brisk, illustrative tour of the not-wonderful world of sludge, with reference to benefit programs, occupational licensing, student visas, and constitutional rights. Different people with different values will have different reactions to the level of burdens in different areas. But with respect to sludge, there is a great deal of room for people who disagree on fundamental issues to make common cause. Chapter 5 investigates the legitimate reasons for sludge, above all, program integrity, which means that sludge can be a way to ensure that people who apply for things actually deserve to get them. People should not receive money to which they are not entitled, and sludge helps to prevent unjustified receipts. Record keeping can also be important. Public and private institutions impose sludge to ensure that they can learn how programs are doing. In addition, sludge can be a way of preventing recklessness and impulsiveness. It can increase the likelihood that people really want to do what they are about to do. By emphasizing justifications for sludge, Chapter 5 can be seen as an effort to restore the balance. Chapter 6 elaborates the idea of sludge audits and urges that they are likely to pay large dividends. The government should be conducting many of them. The same is true of private institutions, which could save a lot of money and a lot of time and improve well-being for countless people, including their own employees. Chapter 6 also explores potential legal reforms coming from all branches of government. While my focus here is on the United States, my hope is that these reforms can be adopted in many nations. Chapter 7 is a brief manifesto identifying the most precious thing that human beings are blessed to have. 1. A curse. In all likelihood, your life has been made worse because of sludge, a viscous mixture consisting of frictions that prevent you from doing what you want to do or from going where you want to go. My first goal here is to understand why sludge is so harmful. My second goal is to see what might be done to reduce that harm. Sludge comes from private and public institutions. It comes from small companies and from large ones. It comes from national governments and from state and local authorities. It comes from the United Nations, the European Commission, and the World Bank. Lawyers impose sludge. So do courts. So do doctors and hospitals. Banks certainly impose sludge. Although the problem of sludge is worse in some countries than in others, it can be found in every nation on the planet. And while my focus is on the United States, the basic lessons are much broader. Sludge is built into the human condition, and we need to start to remove it, piece by piece. In many cases, sludge imposes economic harm. In other cases, it damages public health. In the worst cases, it kills. Every day, it impairs education. Often, it deprives people of educational opportunity. It cripples economic growth. It decreases employment and stifles entrepreneurship and innovation. It hurts patients, parents, teachers, doctors, nurses, employees, customers, investors, and developers. It compromises fundamental rights, including the right to vote and the right to be free from discrimination on the basis of race and sex. It is a pervasive source of inequality. Sludge can also be an assault on human dignity. Confronting sludge and having to find a way to overcome it can create a sense of humiliation. Kafka captures that. His novels depict a world in which people cannot navigate life or escape their predicament because of that viscous mixture. If sludge stops you from voting or from getting some kind of license, you might feel as if you do not count. People without much money struggle with sludge. It hurts all of us, but if you are sick, old, disabled, or poor, or if you don't have a lot of education, sludge is a curse. In 2020, the city of West Sacramento, California, took a small step toward breaking the curse. It automatically admitted every high school student in the area to college and also offered a scholarship award of $200. As Mayor Christopher Cobaldon put it, imagine no one in your family has ever gone to college and you open up an envelope with a letter of admission and a scholarship award. He added that the new effort will make it just as simple to go from high school to college as it is to go from kindergarten to first grade. As we shall see, the idea of automatic admission grows directly out of behavioral science. Even a little sludge in the form of an application process can have large effects. There is every reason to think that taking away the sludge will help a lot of high schoolers to end up in college. More officials should be doing that. Sludge is everywhere in our lives. For a glimpse, consider the following cases. 1. Poor students are entitled to financial aid for college. To obtain that aid, they have to fill out a form. It has dozens of questions, and many students find it challenging to answer some of them. As a result, they decide not to apply for aid at all. 2. To obtain benefits under a healthcare law, people must navigate a complicated website. A lot of them do not understand the questions that they are being asked. For many people, the application takes a long time. Some of them give up. 3. To register a complaint about defective products, consumers are required to go through a time-consuming process. The necessary forms call for detailed information about where the product was originally purchased and how it was used. Some consumers do not have easy access to that information. Others fear that their privacy might be invaded. Many of them decide not to fill out the forms at all. 4. To vote, many citizens of Georgia have to wait in a long line. Sometimes the wait takes 4 hours or more. A number of people cannot spare that time. A number of others think that it is too unpleasant. Some of them do not go to the polls at all. Others leave after an hour. 5. A cell phone company markets some of its products with mail-in rebates. On some products, consumers are entitled to a rebate of $200. The company is well aware that many consumers will be excited about the potential rebate, but they fail to mail in the forms. 6. To fix a broken laptop, consumers have to make a telephone call to a customer service representative and then make an appointment. Once they arrive at the relevant stores, waiting times are often long. They can be up to 2 hours. 7. A professor is asked to review an academic article for a journal. To do so, she must register at the journal's website. Registration is confusing and complicated. As a result, she declines to review the article. Some of these cases are trivial. Others are not. All of them involve sludge, and if you have ever tried to get a license from public officials or some kind of permit, you have encountered it. To get a driver's license, you have to get through sludge. Sometimes there's only a little of it. Sometimes there's a lot. But what, exactly, does the term encompass? If sludge is understood to consist of frictions that separate people from what they want to get, the concept is not entirely mysterious. Much sludge involves waiting time, in person, on the phone, even online. Much of it involves reporting burdens, as when people are required to fill out weekly reports explaining what they have been doing with their lives. Much of it consists of dreary or duplicative application requirements, including time spent online, which might be required if people are seeking to obtain money, medical care, a job, a visa, a permit, or some kind of life-saving help. Much of it involves travel, as when people need to show up somewhere for an in-person interview. Much sludge involves confusing administrative burdens, requiring people to obtain information, to figure out whom to call, to find out exactly what they are supposed to do. Much of it involves clearance processes, familiar within government, as when 10 people must sign off on some document or initiative, and also in the private sector, as at private universities and hospitals. Training requirements imposed, for example, on doctors, nurses, pilots, truck drivers, and flight attendants count as sludge, though they may, of course, be justified. Sludge includes, but goes beyond, red tape, itself a vague idea. If you have to wait in line to vote, or if you have to go to a government office for an interview before receiving a license, you are not exactly facing red tape, but you have to deal with sludge. Sludge is not bureaucracy, though it overlaps with it. The Department of Energy is a bureaucracy, but it is not sludge, though it imposes plenty of it. Sludge can be seen as a kind of transaction cost, a familiar term in economics. But the house of transaction costs has many rooms, and some transaction costs are not sludge. For example, legal fees and brokerage fees are often characterized as transaction costs. They do not count as sludge. The important idea of admin, developed by Elizabeth Emmons, includes sludge, but a lot of admin, such as household labor, is not sludge. Still, the term is not hard-edged, and it does leave unresolved questions. I think it is best not to fuss much over that problem. It is challenging to produce necessary and sufficient conditions for sludge, but in context, it is usually clear enough whether or not we are dealing with it. For conceptual clarity, we should not include strictly monetary incentives or disincentives. Suppose that consumers are told that they must pay a specified amount to obtain insurance, that they have to pay an application fee to enroll in a healthcare program, or that they can obtain a better seat on an airplane for a small additional amount. In such cases, they are unlikely to be thrilled, but they are not facing sludge. A ban is not sludge. If people are forbidden to smoke in public places, sludge is not the problem. A mandate may or may not be sludge, depending on what, exactly, is being mandated. Is sludge itself being mandated? If people are told that they must obtain health insurance, they are facing sludge to the extent that the process of obtaining health insurance involves friction, such as significant paperwork requirements. If people are told that they have to go through an unnecessarily complex process to get a doctor's help with depression or anxiety, they are certainly being required to wade through sludge. If people learn that they need to fill out a lengthy form and have an interview to participate in the Global Entry Program, a terrific program in the United States making travel far less sludgy, they have to face sludge, a little sludge now, in return for a lot less sludge in the future. Not long ago, I asked a group of students about the health care they received at a large university. My question, what could be improved? Two of them singled out the problem of mental health. They said that in order to make an appointment for a mental health issue, they had to make two separate phone calls and fill out some complicated paperwork. They added that the problem of mental illness is stigmatized and that when you are suffering, the last thing you want to do is to find your way through sludge. One of them reported that after a little frustration, she decided that it just wasn't worthwhile to try to make an appointment. This story does not have a tragic ending, But all over the world, people with mental health problems have to deal with sludge. Many of them give up. Is sludge always bad? Certainly not. Sludge can be excessive, insufficient, or optimal. If you are going to do something major with your life, say get divorced, sludge might be an excellent idea. We will get to the details in due course. Are you sure you want to? Questions online can be annoying, but they provide both individual and social benefits. If people are asked to say whether they are sure that they want to delete some important file, waive their legal rights, send an angry email, or post something on social media, the resulting burdens might be an effort to prevent mistakes or recklessness. In due course, I shall provide a detailed account of the legitimate reasons for sludge, but I am here mostly to bury sludge, not to praise it. Nudge and sludge. At this point, some people might be wondering about the relationship between sludge and nudge. For orientation, nudges are private or public initiatives that steer people in particular directions, but that also allow them to go their own way. A reminder is a nudge. So is a warning. A GPS device nudges. A default rule automatically enrolling people in some program is a nudge. To qualify as a nudge, an initiative must not impose significant material incentives, including disincentives. Those who like nudging often emphasize the importance of making it easy. If the goal is to change behavior, it always makes sense to ask, why aren't people doing it anyway? Once we obtain the answer, we can take steps to remove the obstacle, which might be sludge. It should be clear that nudging can be used for both good and bad purposes. Consumers might be defaulted into an expensive healthcare plan that fails to suit their needs. Consumers might be defaulted into an insurance plan for cell phones or laptops that is not at all in their interests. Consumers might be nudged through behaviorally informed advertisements into buying cigarettes or alcohol, even if doing so makes their lives go worse. Nudging is a tool, no less than subsidies, fines, and criminal prohibitions. To evaluate nudges, we need to know their welfare effects, what they are achieving, and at what cost. The best test is simple. Are nudges increasing people's welfare? Are they improving people's lives? Of course, it is true that the idea of welfare needs to be specified, and it is important to emphasize that many people emphasize the importance of fair distribution and would want to pay particular attention to the welfare of the most disadvantaged members of society, prioritarianism. Efforts to ensure that people do not act recklessly can be characterized either as helpful nudges or as sludge. Such efforts are designed to help people act more deliberatively rather than impulsively. The vivid title of an important article makes the point: handgun waiting periods reduce gun deaths. In this light, we can see that some helpful nudges reduce frictions, make it easy, while other helpful nudges increase frictions, make it hard. Nudges that increase frictions can be seen as deliberation promoting, in the sense that they have the goal of encouraging people to think carefully and to give certain courses of action, a purchase, a change in a healthcare or payment plan, a major move of some kind, a kind of sober second thought. In the context of consumer behavior, deliberation promoting nudges can be a blessing. They are an important way of nudging, and in many settings, there should be more of them. We can therefore construct a table with four cells, discussed in Table 1.1. Nudge and sludge overlap in cell 2. Though I will have a fair bit to say about that cell, the principal concern here is cell 4. Reasonable people can, of course, debate its precise.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.